Thank you so much. And with that, I'd like to take a brief moment to ask both of our panelists for their key takeaways. I know they may have reiterated them during the, or they have mentioned them during the presentation, but perhaps they want to reiterate them or maybe even add something to them. We've got a little bit of time before we close. So we'll turn things over to Bob, seeing as we heard from him first. Bob, perhaps you want to give us a few of your key takeaways.
Yes, thank you, Andrew. I would submit a couple of key takeaways from today. First is that defects in construction are really common. If you read the magazines and periodicals that I read as somebody who follows the construction industry, you would be amazed to see how common they are. And at times, it's frightening to see how common they are and how severe they are. And you wonder how those errors or poor work that led to the defects could have been allowed to take place in the first place. So that's one point I would make. The second thing I would point out, and this is very clear from both of our presentations, is having the importance of having the right types and the right amounts of insurance and understanding what you have. Because as I've said several times, where you have construction defects, very often insurance is your primary, if not your sole recourse. So you need to be sensitive to the fact that $1 million face amount of coverage as shown on some certificate of insurance is not necessarily $1 million of coverage in fact, due to the type of policy, whether it's declining balance, due to policy exclusions. And I think this is particularly problematic when you're dealing with CGL coverage, because that's really, you know, very limited coverage, even under the best of circumstances. And the third, takeaway I would mention is, as we've said, the impacts of the pandemic are going to be profound, and they are going to play out over the next couple of years. But people should be aware that there are notice requirements in insurance policies. You can't sit around for a couple of years and say, well, if something comes up, I'll deal with it later. There are notice requirements in most insurance policies, all insurance policies. And so the people who are the insureds under those policies need to be sensitive to those notice requirements so that they don't lose or diminish any of their coverage because they failed to give the proper notices.
Thank you so much for that, Bob. John, perhaps you want to close us out with a few of your key takeaways as well.
All right. Well, I would say there are two things I would like to emphasize. One is that the risk allocation for a construction project needs to be planned out in advance. The general idea should be that the risk should be ultimately borne by who is likely to be in the best position to prevent a defect from occurring. And that would be either the design professional or the subcontractor carrying out, and general contractor carrying out the work. How is that accomplished? It's accomplished in two ways. One is by the contract and subcontract that have appropriate indemnification and hold harmless provisions that allocate responsibility to the party ultimately responsible for that aspect of the job. And secondly, back up to the extent it can be, by insurance, because without insurance in most cases, and in particular in the case of subcontractors, there's not going to be any other resource for recovery. And then the other related point I would make is this, that there should, as I mentioned before, the owner should be mentioned as an additional insured. I agree 100% with what Bob said before. Certificates of insurance cannot be relied upon. And for the various reasons that Bob pointed out, they are, in order to make sure that the risk allocation is in place and covered, you need to see the policies themselves.